Hi. So the work we are presenting today is GABL, a strategy-proof ascending bid auction mechanism for dynamic license shared access. This is a joint work with my advisor, Mahesh. Now, several diverse wireless technologies use the wireless spectrum for communication, ranging from radios that broadcast over a few hundred kilometers to personal area networks that have a coverage area of a few meters, and equally diverse are their requirements for data rate and quality of service as well. Now, recently in the industry, the demand for wireless spectrum is growing at much higher rate than the capacity that they have. And however, it's well understood that this is an artificial spectrum scarcity that is mostly due to inefficient regulatory spectrum access models. So as Cengiz discussed before, we have licensed and unlicensed spectrum access models, with licensed spectrum access model providing interference protection, but it comes at a high initial cost, right? But with unlicensed spectrum, you have a low entry barrier, but it's very difficult to guarantee any quality of service. Now, the licensed shared access is an upcoming spectrum access model that tries to bring in the best of both worlds, right? So it tries to offer interference protection, but at a low entry cost. So let's look at this model. So there are three entities in the model, right? So the incumbent spectrum user is the entity who has licensed spectrum, but it's underutilized. The LSA repository is the entity who maintains the details of what spectrum is used, where, and how, etc. Now, the LSA licensees are operators who are interested in using these underutilized spectrum for a shorter period of time in a particular location, et cetera. A typical conversation transaction between them would go something like this, where the incumbent spectrum user informs the LSA repository saying, I don't use this particular channel in Paderborn for the next couple of weeks, so feel free to sell them, right? Now, an LSA licensee who wants to use such a spectrum would request that particular information from the LSA repository saying, is it okay if I use this channel for a couple of hours? And the repository replies back saying, okay, you can, but subject to these conditions and so on. Right? But to incentivize the incumbent spectrum users to release more and more spectrum, we believe auctions are an effective market mechanism here. And one of the main objectives we have here is to incentivize incumbents and improve spectrum availability in the secondary market. Now, a typical auction would go something like this, right? So you have the bidders and the auctioneers. The bidders submit their bids to the auctioneer. The auctioneer computes winners and then just informs the bidder saying, you won these channels, you can use so on and so forth. Now, these are the properties that we believe are important for an auction scheme that should be applied to the LSA market, right? So let's look at some of these quickly. So strategy proofness. So this is a well understood concept. Now, in this case, in the auction scheme, if bidding truthfully is the best strategy for every bidder, then the auction is called strategy proof, right? Now, quickly looking at an example where two users are interested in a painting. If you take a first price auction, then the best strategy for bidder B is to bid 7,000. Whereas in the first price auction, the winner pays the price he bids, right? In the second price auction, the winner pays the opportunity cost, which is the second highest bid, right? So in that case, the best bid is 10,000, which is just his valuation. But if you look at first price auction, which is an example of a non-strategy proof auction, the bidder has to come up with a strategy here. So the utility he gets eventually depends on what strategy he follows, right? Which is not very good for the auction scheme. It doesn't encourage people to participate. Now, the second one is spectrum heterogeneity. In an LSA market, we expect channels from different bands which have diverse propagation characteristics. And also, not all channels will be available at all locations, right? So in this particular example, let's say there are three nodes, three transmitters, and they're using 3.6 gigahertz, right? Now, they're not interfering with each other. Now, the conflict graph is shown here. Now, let's say in case they use 2.4 gigahertz, they, due to difference propagation characteristic, they're going to have a slightly larger range, right? Now, in this case, A interferes with B and B interferes with C, which is shown in the conflict graph, right? But let's say they use 700 megahertz. Now in this case, all of them interfere with each other and the conflict graph becomes a completely connected graph, right? Now this is something that the auction scheme should be able to handle. Now, the third one is channel sharing. Now we want to be able to sell channels to interfering users as well, right? Now this increases accessibility to the spectrum, it satisfies certain low data rate requirements, but more importantly, sharing moves us towards efficient spectrum use. The last one here is privacy protection. In a strategy-proof auction, especially in a second prize auction, we believe that the highest bid should be protected from the auctioneer. Now, take this example where the auctioneer is a rogue auctioneer. Now, because he's the only one with access to all the bids, now he could always lie and let the bidder B know that the second highest bid is actually 9,000 and not 7,000, in which case bidder B has to pay 9,000 and the auctioneer gets more profit, but so that's where, that's one of the reasons why we need to protect the highest bids from the auctioneer. However, general auctions cannot be directly applied to spectrum. For example, consider these two cases where we have spectrum reuse and channel sharing. A typical object you don't sell to two people, whereas a channel can be sold to two people if they're not interfering with each other. And even if they're interfering with each other, if you want to allow channel sharing, then the same channel can be sold to two bidders. Now, in 2008, Veritas was the first strategy-proof auction that was proposed for short-term dynamic sharing. However, since then, several issues have been uncovered with Veritas, and some of which we discussed before. And several auction schemes have been proposed to solve some of these issues, right? Now, qualitatively looking at which properties these auction mechanisms solve, we look at those four properties we discussed before: strategy proofness, heterogeneous channels, fine-grained channels, and which channel sharing and privacy protection, right? And what we see is that while all of them support strategy proof, only some of them support each of the other properties that we're interested in, and none of them support all the properties, right? Now, this is curious. Now, while trying to understand what is the difficulty in supporting all of these properties, what we find interesting is that all of these problems can be traced to the underlying auction format and not due to prize and winner determination strategies, right? Now, all of these problems can be traced back to two particular behavioral characteristics, which is information bias and critical neighbor identification, right? Now, let's look at information bias. So in a typical sealed bid auction, the bidders submit their bids to the auctioneer and the auctioneer announces the winners and prices. In this case, what you see here, the auctioneer is the only entity with access to all the bids. Right? Now the bidders, they don't have access to any of the other bidders or any other information from the market. So this is the information bias that we're talking about. This information bias is what enables the auctioneer to lie about the highest bid. If everybody knows the bid, then he wouldn't. Or if the auctioneer doesn't know the highest bid, then he wouldn't. But it's the information bias that causes this problem. Now, the second thing is critical neighbor identification. Now, in order to determine prices, right, second prices, especially with conflict graphs like this, you need to be able to identify a neighbor who you call the critical neighbor, which is in order to identify the opportunity cost, you want to identify the neighbor who has the highest losing bid, right? Let's take this example where we have a conflict graph with four bidders, and these are channels that are available in their locations. And let's say they have the following valuations and bids, right? Now, let's say a particular greedy mechanism is used to allocate. This is all to show why there is difficulty in identifying the highest losing bid in a typical spectrum auction. So in this case, the valuations are, A has the highest valuation, second highest is B, and third highest is D, and the one with the least valuation is C, right? In this case, because it's a greedy allocation, the following channel allocations follow. So A is allocated C1, C2, and D is allocated C1. Finally, when it comes to C's chance, there's no more channels left to allocate. Okay? Now, if C lies about its valuation and says its actual valuation is, let's say, 4, now what happens? Now C gets more priority compared to D, right? So C gets channel C1 and whatever is remaining goes to D, but C is able to improve its utility by lying. So this is non-strategy proof, right? So this shows an example of difficulty here in identifying the critical neighbor. Now, this is what we saw with homogeneous channels, right? Now, with heterogeneous spectrum, what you see is you may have a different conflict graph for each channel because they have different propagation characteristics, as we saw before. Right? Now, on top of it, if you include channel sharing, then potentially all of them could be winners. Now, this increases the complexity of identifying the critical neighbor, right? So on top of this, if you add privacy protection, which existing schemes use order-preserving encryption schemes to prevent the auctioneer from knowing the highest bids, it becomes even more complicated. Now, is there an alternative? It turns out there is. Now, ascending bid auctions are multi-round auction mechanisms that can produce the same outcome as a second price auction scheme or a sealed bid auction scheme. Now, we also see that it avoids information bias and there's no need to identify critical neighbors, right? Let's look at what ascending bid auctions are. So in the market, what you have are bidders and the auctioneer. When the auction begins, the auctioneer announces a round price saying, this is the current round price. If you're interested, if you want to know that, if you're interested, tell me your demand, right? Now the bidders respond with their demands. Now the auctioneer checks to see if there is excess demand, right? Now, if there is excess demand, he increments the round price and the whole process goes on and on again. Now, let's take the same example and see how it works, right? Now, the auctioneer starts off by announcing a round price of 5,000. Now, both the bidders are interested. There's excess demand. So the auctioneer increments the round price to 6,000. Now, there's still demand. Nothing changes. But at 7,000, what we see is bidder G doesn't have a positive utility anymore. So he drops out, he doesn't have a demand. Now the demand can be satisfied, so B wins, but the price is 7,000. That's the price he pays. So this automatically gets you the second price, right? Finally, there's no more excess demand and the auction finishes, right? But just as how we saw in sealed bid auctions, ascending bid auctions cannot directly be applied to dynamic spectrum sharing. So, in the interest of time, we explain GAVL, which is our proposed mechanism, with an example here. So let's take this example. We have five bidders here, and this is the conflict graph that we see. And these are the channels that are available in each of their locations. What you notice here is heterogeneous channel availability. For example, B has channel C1 and C2, whereas A has channel C1, C2, and C3. Now, this is what we expect in the market. Now, this is the valuations, private valuations for each of the channels. For example, bidder A values channel C1 at 13 and so on. Now, these are the steps we discussed in the previous slide. And in order to compute excess demand, what we essentially do is, what this translates to is, if the demand for a particular channel at this locality is less than one, then that's what we consider as excess demand. Let's look at it with an example. So at the beginning of the auction, the auctioneer announces a round price and the bidders respond with their demands here. Here, A basically says, I want 60% of channel C1 and I want 100% of channel C2 and so on. At this point, what you notice is the demand for channel C3 at bidder A, if you notice, the total demand is only about 0.7. So just to look at it a bit more carefully, so what we see here is at A's location, the total demand for channel C3 from A as well as from all of its neighbors is less than one, which means at this price, whatever demand is there, it can be satisfied, right? So this we just follow through, and at this point in time, this channel is allocated to the bidder A. Now, after that, there's excess demand, so the auction keeps going on. And at this round price, what we notice is the demand for channel C1 from C goes to zero, right? Because at 4, it doesn't have demand anymore. At 4, the demand drops to zero. Now, the consequence of this is now both A's and B's demand for channel C1 can be satisfied, right? So at this point in time, for at price 4, these two channels are allocated. Channel C1 is allocated to both A and B. And similarly, what we see here is because D's demand drops to zero, now E's demand for channel C2 can now be satisfied, right? So at this point in time, E's allocated channel C2. And the auction proceeds, and similarly, other channels are allocated, and it goes to this particular price vector, where at this point in time, there's no more excess demand, and the auction ends, right? So the final allocation looks something like this. Right. So this is the valuations, the green shading show what channels were won by which bidder, and this shows the fraction of channels that were won and the price at which the channel was won. Right? Now, there are two observations we make here. One is the channels are always sold to the bidder with the highest valuation in their locality. Right? Now, the second observation we make here is it automatically identifies the opportunity cost in that neighborhood. For example, for channel C1, you see the price that A paid was actually 4, which is the opportunity cost, because in the locality, the highest losing neighbor was actually C, which who had a valuation of 4, and that's the price that's being charged, which is the opportunity cost. Right? Okay. Now let's look at how these problems. Now let's look at how ascending bid auctions are affected by these problems. Right? Now, information bias. What you notice here is the auction ends at the second highest price. After that, it just does not proceed. So even though A's valuation for channel C1 was 13, the auction ended at 4. Right? So the auctioneer never gets to know the highest bid. So there is no information bias. On the other hand, the bidders are now able to gauge there is an option for market price discovery based on the demand. So hence, information bias is completely avoided. Now, the second thing is critical neighbor identification. In order to identify that highest losing neighbor, we need to identify that critical neighbor. Right? But in this case, we never had to identify that critical neighbor because the price at which the excess demand goes away is the price at which we sell it. So there is no need to identify critical neighbors at all. So that is how it avoids all of these problems. The auction mechanism takes in these three inputs. It takes the conflict graph for all the channels, the private valuation from each of the bidders, and the wrong price vector. And it computes winners and prices, right? Now, these are the metrics that we evaluate with, the social welfare, revenue, spectrum utilization, and percentage of winners. Now, to compare with, we formulate an LP formulation and for each of these objectives separately, and we compare it with that for an upper bound, and we also compare with two other schemes that were recently proposed, where Smashwood GR supports everything, all of these properties except privacy protection, and Aegis MP supports all of this except channel sharing and privacy protection. Now. Again, in the interest of time, we only discuss social welfare. So the optimal scheme performs the best because the objectives are different from the auction mechanism itself, and that's why we see this difference. But Gavel, the proposed mechanism, which is the green curve here, it actually performs better than the other two existing schemes because with Aegis MP, there is no channel sharing. That is a major cost for loss of social welfare here, because in the neighborhood, only a single winner is there for every channel. Right? For Smashwood GR, the gap between Gavel and Smashwood GR can be explained by the fact that there are certain channel sharing opportunities that other auction mechanisms, they don't utilize all of the channel sharing opportunities because some of them would violate the strategy proofness. So this is the difference we see here. To summarize, we saw how license sharing access, spectrum access model has the potential to improve spectrum availability, and how existing mechanisms don't satisfy all of these design properties, and how the problems can actually be traced to the underlying sealed bid auction format. And we saw how ascending bid auctions does not suffer from the same problems, mainly due to the information bias and the critical neighbor identification bit. And based on these observations, we propose Gavel, a strategy-proof ascending bid auction mechanism that is well suited for dynamic license shared access. Thank you. Take questions now.